The oldest light in the universe, according to the Big Bang Theory, is the cosmic microwave background, the leftover radiation from the Big Bang itself. The only source of radiation we've ever discovered that comes to us from all directions of the sky.
The cosmic microwave background is the afterglow of the Big Bang. It's the radiation coming at us from the Big Bang, the leftover radiation. It's amazing. In fact, it's highly visible in a sense, but it wasn't discovered until 1965 in New Jersey, of all places, by two people who didn't know what the heck they were doing, but they won the Nobel Prize anyway. But in fact, you've actually seen it. Well, if you've ever disconnected your cable TV, or if you're old, like me, old enough to remember before cable TV, when the stations went off the air at night, after the test pattern, there'd be static. If you disconnect the cable on your TV, you'll see static. Turns out about 1% of the static you can see in your TV is radiation left over from the Big Bang.
This background radiation should be isotropic. It should define no special direction in the universe, and certainly not one related in any way to us. Max Tegmark decided to look at the cosmic microwave background in a new way. And he discovered something amazing.
I decided to look at the data in a different way by separating it into what we call spherical harmonics. And each one of those harmonics corresponds to a picture you can look at on your screen. And I wrote this computer program and like 3 in the morning was done. And I hit enter and poof, up came a picture and whoa. Crazy. I had typed in 2, which was the lowest one of these modes, and it didn't look at all like it was supposed to do. I had looked at this because there had been previous papers saying maybe there was something a little fishy about this lowest harmonic, but nobody had ever made a picture of it before because they couldn't clean out all the junk. And checked my program, there was nothing seemingly wrong with it. So I thought, I'm kind of tired, but I have to type in 3. And see what the next one looks like. And that one looked even more crazy. It had this big band, like a pancake across the sky. And it was lined up with what came out when I had typed in 2. Like, whoa, what is going on here? So we mentioned this sort of in passing at the end of our paper, that there was this funny alignment, which later got dubbed the axis of evil. And we did another paper and realized that it's actually quite unlikely that it's just a fluke. And then later on, other people, like Dragan Hutterer and many others, picked up on this and did much more careful studies and found that actually there was nothing wrong in my computer program, and the effect was there, and even more strongly so than we had guessed.
When you look at the cosmic microwave background, it's uniform in all directions, which is what you'd expect for the universe, in fact. Another bit of evidence that there really was a Big Bang. But there have been some anomalies.
There's one point about it that the radiation isn't exactly isotropic, it's almost.
So they send out this satellite and they find out, wow, there's anisotropies out there. It's not smooth. Not only did they find anisotropies, what they found was that these anisotropies, these disturbances, these temperature disturbances throughout the universe were all pointing to the Earth.
This is, if you just look at the galaxies out there in the universe, it doesn't matter whether you look at them like this or whether you tilt your head like this or like that, because there is no special direction. There's no up or down in space.
One of the fundamental principles of cosmology is the Copernican principle that we believe that the Earth does not occupy a special position.
Yet, there is this very special direction imprinted in these baby pictures of the universe. And it's pretty clear now, since many different groups have hammered at this, that it's real. It's in there in the data. What's much less clear is what it means.
The cosmic microwave background alignments do not define a center, but instead an axis, a preferred direction spanning the entire universe. The fact that these alignments are correlated to our own neighborhood is highly difficult to explain from within the assumptions of Big Bang cosmology. The dipole, which is aligned with our equinox, is usually attributed to a relative motion between our solar system and the cosmic background itself. However, the quadrupole and octopole alignments are also with respect to the ecliptic, the plane of the orbit of the planets around the sun.
Some people have actually suggested that the there's structure in the cosmic microwave background radiation that's related to where the Earth is and how it's going around the sun, which is crazy, because we're nothing special.
Professor Lawrence Krauss, writing back in 2006, addressed these strange anomalies in the cosmic microwave background as follows.
He says this, but when you look at the CMB map, you also see that the structure that is observed is in fact, in a weird way, correlated with the plane of the Earth around the sun. Is this Copernicus coming back to haunt us? That's crazy. We're looking out at the whole universe. There's no way there should be a correlation of structure with our motion of the Earth around the sun. The plane of the Earth around the sun, the ecliptic? That would say we are truly the center of the universe, unquote.
In 2005, I was talking about the observation and what it would imply, but it's so strange that it's likely to be wrong. Now, that doesn't mean it's always wrong, and some things are so strange that they're actually right. But in this case, I suspect that the structure that was seen by some people that suggested that, you know, the whole microwave background is arranged around us is probably not right.
If you run up against an interpretation that sounds viable and credible, that's not Copernican, it's thrown out.
And so I can see the resistance there, you know, that if you, like a heretic, you know, you come out and you say, hey, no, this is not right. There is evidence that this cosmological principle, this idea that we're not in any special place in the universe, there's something wrong with that.
That whole cosmic microwave background is pointing to us, this tiny little space in the universe, and that happens to be where we live.
I frankly try to keep an open mind about what this ultimately means, because I still don't know.
As a matter of fact, you can go on some websites of NASA and see that they've started to take down stuff that might hint to a geocentric universe.
Now, whenever there's something weird, it's wonderful if you get a fresh measurement of it. So I'm really keen to see what the Planck satellite pictures are going to look like, if they are going to have the same weird alignment. And they're going to have even better ability also to clean out noise from the galaxy and other sources. So I'm keeping all options on the table until then.
The strangeness of the alignment of cosmic microwave background with the ecliptic and equinoxes of Earth led many cosmologists to believe that the Planck satellite mission would finally show these alignments to have been a mistake, a foreground that wasn't subtracted properly, or a scanning beam anomaly in the WMAP telescope. Would the axis of evil turn out to be real? Finally, on March 21st, 2013, at the headquarters of the European Space Agency in Paris, the results of the Planck satellite mission were publicly released.
Today we are going to present to you the cosmic microwave background. Progress towards the future by understanding the past.
This map is a gold mine of information.
The stakes were high. If Planck were to confirm the existence of the axis of evil, it could mean the foundational principle of modern cosmology, the Copernican principle, is wrong. Planck was expected by many to show instead that the strange CMB axis of evil was nothing more than foreground contamination or a scanning beam anomaly somehow missed by the WMAP team. We flew back to Boston to interview Max Tegmark at MIT. We asked him whether his discovery of the axis of evil had been confirmed or debunked by Planck.
It was just so exciting. I'm standing there shaving at 5 a.m. while I'm watching George Evstathiou on the live feed press conference. And when the first image comes up on the screen, I line it up with this cleaned image of the data that we had made way back in the past. And it all matches. This spot matches this spot. This one matches this spot. And I'm thinking to myself, whoa. This is so awesome. And the axis of evil is obviously there because all the big spots are in the same places. So all these puzzling anomalies have survived. And the axis of evil is still with us. And we have to actually ask us what it means.
But what about the alignments with the ecliptic and equinoxes, which Lawrence Krauss had said would mean we were really the center of the universe? We asked Max Tegmark if Planck's results had convinced him that the axis of evil actually was aligned with our ecliptic and equinoxes.
I have to confess that I was bothered by the fact that the axis of evil seemed linked to a special direction in our solar system. And something in my gut was telling me that this might, even though I greatly trust the people on the Double Map team, point to something fishy in their analysis. But I also feel very strongly that I have to actually override my gut by using my brain and by looking at data. And now we have completely independent data with better detectors, completely different people seeing the same thing. So there's just no way we can blame this on the Double Map team. There is, I think, a real possibility that the axis of evil and other strange things we see in the large scales of the cosmic microwave background are a hint of something really big, just the tip of an iceberg, something huge.
So now we're in a position to look at the entire microwave sky. First, we introduce the multipoles. The dipole, usually attributed to a relative motion between our local system and the CMB itself. The quadrupole, the north and south ecliptic poles, and the spring and fall equinoxes. The S-shaped line represents the plane of the ecliptic, the plane of the orbit of the planets around the sun. Notice how it neatly divides warm and cold sections of the CMB map. This is our first hint that something very unusual is going on. Now we transform our Molveda projection into a sphere and rotate our universe so that the S-shaped line of the ecliptic becomes the dark line across the center of the sphere. This plane, lying between the warm and cold areas of the CMB, will become the grid along which we fly through the entire visible universe. From the point at which space first becomes transparent and structure begins to form, through the Virgo supercluster, and finally, to our own Milky Way galaxy. As we enter it, amazingly, we arrive at our own local neighborhood. Our sun, and finally, our home. So does this mean that the pendulum has started to swing back away from the Copernican principle? Could this, in fact, be Copernicus coming back to haunt us?
Now, today, fortunately, we don't burn astronomers alive anymore, which I think is a good thing.
Life may be very rare, and we may be very special, but that doesn't mean the universe was created just for us.
I've really changed my opinion in a major way and how I feel about our place in the cosmos. For many years, I was feeling more and more insignificant. We realized that we humans were just living on a small planet in a solar system, in a galaxy, in this universe. We just kept getting smaller. Then we realized we're not even made of the majority kind of substance, you know, dark matter and dark energy. And then we realized that we're also very brief. Our 100-year lifespans, you know, compared to the 14 billion-year age of the universe. So how could we possibly be significant? But I've really completely changed my mind, and now I actually think we're very significant.
The very successes of science have led it to this moment of truth. It now confronts the very same questions which were once considered the domain of metaphysics, even of theology.
We are asking about ultimate things. What is the bedrock of the world? What is time? What is motion? These are the most fundamental things.
Oh, this cosmic microwave background is like we are seeing the fingerprint of God, the hallmarks of the Creator.
Because nobody believes that the universe comes to an end just where we can see.
It's been remarkably difficult to come up with any physical theory that just makes exactly what we see, then stops.
Thank you.
you know, I'm a great advocate of the multiverse and the idea that, you know, our universe is just one of many, you know, this progression in the Copernican concept.
Multiverse, the hypothesis that an unending number of universes exist, the main purpose being to answer what is commonly understood as the fine-tuning problem, namely, that our single universe operates within a very narrow margin of physical constants and could not have come into existence by chance.
We are made out of electrons. If each electron is in multiple places at the same time, then am I not also multiple places at the same time? And the answer is yes. Now apply this quantum principle to the universe. If the universe obeys uncertainty, then you don't know where the Big Bang was. The Big Bang could have been here, the Big Bang could have been there, just like electrons. You don't know where the electrons is. So this means you have multiple universes. So as soon as you apply the quantum principle to the universe, immediately you get parallel universes.
And some people don't like it and call it a crisis. I call it a multiverse.
I think the multiverse has really come about because of a whole range of fine-tuning issues. The Goldilocks-type universe, the laws of physics finely tuned, the existence of humans.
The multiverse is an attempt to take quantum mechanics and give every possible answer as a yes.
There could be an infinite number of universes, and the energy in empty space would be different in each one. And only in those which the energy empty space is comparable to what we see would galaxies have formed and life would have formed. So it's kind of a cosmic natural selection. It's not fine-tuning, it's not religious, like some people think. It's the opposite.
Yes, you can get all sorts of answers predictively, but it doesn't provide the mechanisms and it doesn't determine things properly.
There are actually a variety of approaches that come from both cosmology and from particle physics, which predict that there could be many other universes.
By inventing all of these other universes that are unobservable, unverifiable.
If you have a mechanism for producing one Big Bang, it's going to produce other Big Bangs, and therefore it would seem fairly logical there should be many other universes.
The multiverse hypothesis, the problem in a sense is it can explain too much. In a multiverse, as various people have proposed, anything you want happens here, something else. You can take anything you want and you can explain it by the multiverse. That means it has incredible explanatory power, but it also means there's effectively nothing you can do to test it.
In trying to figure out all these anomalies that they see in the universe that don't fit the Copernican principle, what this leads to is creating a whole bunch of universes, billions and billions. It goes on ad infinitum. Somewhere in all those universes, there's going to be something that's not geocentric, you see, and that's how we can get out of the problem.
There's a geocentric universe in the multiverses. There's a heliocentric one. There's a jovocentric one centered on Jupiter on by this hypothesis.
It's a very, very interesting hypothesis. One can make good reasons why it's a good model to believe in, but there isn't any direct way to prove the multiverse is correct observationally.
We cannot directly observe these other universes because, remember, the point is we cannot observe beyond 40 billion light years.
Got to be careful when we claim the mantle of science for some of what comes out. I'm very happy to claim the mantle of scientifically based philosophy for what comes out, but I'm worried when we're claiming the mantle of science.
The fine tunings, if we're the only universe, the fine tunings are really hard to explain unless you're going to invoke a creator or something.
We seem to find ourselves in a part of the universe that is perfectly tuned for life.
On the other hand, if you have got a multiverse, then it's fairly natural by a simple selection effect that we are going to be in one of the universes which is going to allow life to arise.
Saying there's many universes doesn't really answer anything, does it? Because it doesn't deal with the universe we're in, assuming it's even true.
Where are we going to find ourselves in the multiverse? The only place we're going to find ourselves is where we can survive.
I would agree that the alternative is between a multiverse and God. It-